Let's read the Lord's Prayer together. And when you come to Thy Kingdom Come, you can say it a little bit louder, because that's what we're going to talk about this morning. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The Gospel of Matthew presents Jesus as the King of the Jews. Also, it is truly the book of Matthew, the Gospel of the Kingdom. In the midst of this sermon, our Lord gives his disciples the model prayer. And the second petition, which we're going to be talking about, is Thy Kingdom Come. Now you're probably wondering, how can you give a sermon on three words? Well, let me tell you, Thy Kingdom Come has probably caused more debate, more theologians to scratch their head, and also there's a lot of things that we don't understand when it comes to Thy Kingdom Come. But we're going to try to give you a little insight about what it means in that prayer, Thy Kingdom Come. Thy calls our attention to the nature of the kingdom. It is the kingdom that belongs to God. And that gives us a lot of reassurance. And that someday, the devil is really going to pay a big price for knowing that God is in charge of the kingdom. The kingdom of God is the dynamic reign of God as king, as existing in the both present and also in the future. And he affirmed this in the teaching to his disciples. The kingdom of God is within or among you. When one accepts Jesus as their Lord and Savior, the kingdom of God is reigning within your life. I think that's a big statement to make. That the kingdom of God, if you're a Christian, is reigning within your life. Jesus surely taught that the kingdom of God had to come to earth in his ministry. He pointed to his critics, said that his miracles were a sign that the kingdom of God was near at hand. But Jesus also spoke of the kingdom of God as something that is in the future. He talks about his coming kingdom. And today, let's talk about two aspects of Thy Kingdom Come. Number one point, the Lord's Prayer is a petition that God will rule in our hearts. A confession of need is the petition from Thy Kingdom Come. And it could be understood as a confession that another ruler is now in charge. But let us remember that if you're a Christian, God is in charge of your life. Not yourself, nor the devil, but if you have the kingdom of God within your heart, God is in charge. The world has never been without a ruler. Since the very fatal act of man in the Garden of Eden, man has been under the kingdom of darkness, and that Satan as its prince. The devil is the active ruler in this kingdom. So this prayer is a petition for the replacement of the rule of Satan within, and also to have the rule of God within your own life. And it's also a missionary appeal as well. Those who accept Jesus as Lord and Savior are removed from the kingdom of darkness and placed under the rule of our Lord Jesus Christ. So when you're praying, thy kingdom come, you're praying for what? That you want Jesus to rule and not Satan within your life. The kingdom of God is present in our hearts in a very spiritual way. According to what Jesus told Nicodemus, a spiritual birth is necessary to be transferred from the kingdom of flesh to the kingdom of God. Let me say that one more time. When you ask Jesus to say, thy kingdom come, you're being transferred from the kingdom of flesh to the kingdom of God. Isn't that a great, great thing to know when you're praying, thy kingdom come? So a prayer for the coming of the kingdom of God can be understood as a prayer that the rule of God may be extended to other hearts through the heeding of the gospel of God's dear Son through repentance, faith, and baptism. To ask for thy kingdom is a very personal request. This prayer, thy kingdom come, also has some important personal implication as it relates to the present. When we receive Jesus as Lord, we begin to know his saving power. We gain further insight for asking, when thy kingdom come. We become progressively aware of the completeness of God's rule in our lives. We have acknowledged Jesus as Lord, yet finding ourselves struggling also and through our whole life with his lordship. Unfortunately, I think we'll all have to admit that we do have a sinful inclination to withhold parts of our lives under his rule. We find resistance to his rule. This prayer is an acknowledgement of our struggle and is a request that God's rule will be imposed in a complete way in our hearts. Do you see why it's so important to pray the Lord's Prayer? We struggle, and therefore we're asking God to help us to have complete rule, even in some of the lives in which, part of our lives that we struggle with. It is a prayer of submission when we pray, thy kingdom come. Thy kingdom come, we're requesting you come into our hearts. Thy kingdom come, we're saying, come into my business. Thy kingdom come, come into my home. Thy kingdom come, come into all of the affairs of my life. Remember that poem, If Jesus Came to Your House Today? I think there was even a poem written about that. In other words, would you be ashamed to have Jesus come into your house? Would you have to put some magazines away? Would you have to get out and dust off the Bible? No. Our goal is to have complete reign of Jesus within our life. So that's the number one point, that he will rule. Thy kingdom come. Come into my life fully. Not just partially, all the way. And that's why we pray this prayer, thy kingdom come. A second petition is the future rule of our Lord Jesus Christ. Second point. We pray for thy kingdom come. We ask God to have a dethronement of the Satan and evil. Jesus never deceived his disciples. He never encouraged them to believe that they would be successful in alienating Satan within their lives by themselves. He always made it clear that he was the one that was going to have Jesus rule within their life. And without the help of the Holy Spirit, we haven't a chance against the devil. The coming of the kingdom of God will involve an invasion by the sovereign king himself. This is the great theme of the book of Revelation. God is someday going to intervene in human affairs. The kingdom of evil, which Satan rules, will be crushed by the mighty Son of God. It is a prayer for the king to come to bind Satan and to put him in the bottomless pit and dethrone every enemy of God. It's also a request to make his enemies his footstool and to close down every power that is opposed to God. The Bible mentions the thousand-year reign of Christ. And it's mentioned in the Bible not just once. It's mentioned six times, which is called the millennium. The enthronement of Christ will be visible to all. The reigning of the saints with Christ will happen, and as it's mentioned several times in the Lord's teaching, thy kingdom coming will also involve the enthronement of the Lord Jesus Christ and his people. He is to exercise rule over the earth with a rod of iron, and he will be truly crowned the Prince of Peace. If we could comprehend what this means, thy kingdom come, I'm sure that we would pray this more earnestly. The coming kingdom will mean the removal of the curse and the restoration of the earth. The coming of the kingdom is the hope of the whole creation that loves God. Paul tells us in Romans that the whole creation is groaning like a woman in childbirth in the anticipation of this day. It will be a beautiful redemption and healing for the earth. Now, I know that many people will disagree when this will happen. And I'm not sure I can define all the things that will happen in the thousand-year reign of Christ. But we do know one thing. Eventually, Christ will reign. As we know, one day to the Lord is a thousand years. I don't know. Maybe, and I don't know if it's figurative or just how long that will be. I'm not sure I have the answer for all the questions about the millennium or the thousand year of Christ. And I'm not alone in my view because we have three different views. I know the premillennialist looks for Christ's visible return before the thousand years of reign of Christ. I know also that the postmillennialists hold that Christ will return after the millennium, and the amillennialist denies the thousand-year reign. And so you can see that when I said that thy kingdom come is a debate that will go on until Jesus comes back again, you see what I mean. But whatever you believe, one thing is sure. Christ will reign eventually, and we better be ready for his second coming. Our hope of his coming kingdom will happen. Yes, nations will continue to be troubled with wars and rumors of war until his kingdom comes. But under the rule of Jesus, they will turn their destructive weapons into instruments made for mankind's welfare, and the earth will no war, no more. We could probably sing that song, you know, no war, or steady war, no war anyway. But peace will reign in God's kingdom. This is coming of God's kingdom is the hope of the individual Christian. I know that we can get pretty discouraged the way that our world is going right now. You can be sure of one thing. Eventually, Christ will win. Satan will be buried in the bottomless pit. And we will be victorious. And that's why we should be evangelistic in our efforts. Because all those people that do not acknowledge Jesus as their Lord and Savior will go along with Satan to that bottomless pit. So we have a lot of work to do. We have a lot of work to do in Lisbon to warn people that Christ will reign. Will you be with Christ or will you be with the devil? It's so important that we warn people that Jesus is coming again. Neil Howe and Bill Strauss wrote a book called about the 13th generations entitled Abort, Retry, Ignore, and Fail. This book is about America's 13th generation. What is the 13th generation? It's the people that were born in 1961 between and then also through 1981. I don't know, a raise of hand, we don't have too many people probably in that particular category. But this is the generation, it's the 13th since the American founding father has been the victim of bad luck and bad timing. The 13th generation was the first whose mothers took pills not to have children. Also, it was the generation first to go through the divorce revolution. And also, it was the first generation to go to school when schools stopped teaching traditional curriculum. As a result, they have a strange combination of optimism and pessimism about life. They individually are optimistic and collectively pessimistic, Neil Howitt said. I likened them to a group of skydivers hurtling to the ground with only one parachute among them, but each one expects to get the parachute. The Bible is also marked by a striking combination of optimism and pessimism. The scriptures are absolutely pessimistic about humankind's ability to solve their own problems, which we're getting exact opposite in school. They're teaching in school that we are the answer to our own problem and that we can handle anything that comes our way. The Bible doesn't teach that. We are helpless without the Lord Jesus Christ in our life. And our future is very dim unless we know Jesus as Savior. This needs to be taught in schools. It shouldn't be taught that we can conquer the world. We can do this. We can do that. The scriptures are plain. Our life is hopeless without the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible is absolutely optimistic about our future if we have Jesus. But the Bible teaches also we are helpless without His great help in our life. We need Jesus as our Savior and Lord. Conclusion. Are you willing to pray, "Thy kingdom come"? Are you ready to have that as a personal prayer for your life? Are you ready for Jesus to rightly be crowned king over all your life and all your affairs? Are you ready to make the prayer, "Thy kingdom come," an ultimate expression of how you really feel about the Lord Jesus Christ? Are you willing to have Him rule completely? Many of us want Jesus just at our request when we need help. But if you're asking, "Thy kingdom come," you're asking Jesus to take complete rule and ownership of your life. Maybe there's someone here that would like to pray that prayer today. We're asking that you pray that prayer, "Thy kingdom come," over all my life, not just part of it, all of it. And that's our prayer today. Let's pray.